And good evening. Thank you so much for tuning in to Healthline here on PBS 39 HD. My name is Mark Evans, your host, and we'll be talking about foot issues, podiatry issues, if you will, throughout the program, talking about foot concerns and proper foot care. As a matter of fact, we have two doctors who specialize in what they do in foot care back on the panel tonight. Dr. Dennis Chubinski, a podiatrist and also a foot surgeon. Great to have you back.
Thank you.
And then Dr. Vincent Coda is here. He's also a podiatrist and foot surgeon. Good to have you back, sir.
Thank you.
Kind of sounds like a comedy team. Vincent Dennis and Vincent, or Chubinski and Coda. Coda and Chubinski.
Well, we have all sorts of permutations of that.
So. I bet you do. Yeah. I bet you do. Well, we try to keep it light and lively. We do talk about feet on this particular program, and a lot of people have foot issues, as I always have to say during the program, the agony of defeat. I suffer from some of those myself. The telephone number is on your screen, 969-2720. And long distance is 866-969-2720. Want to start off, I got some news before the show started that both of you just recently came back from trips of one fashion or another. Dr. Coda, you just got back from Guatemala.
Yeah, we did reconstructive foot surgery in Guatemala. We did 31 surgical procedures on 25 patients in 4 days.
And this was mission work.
Yes, it was.
You and some other physicians went. And
there was a general surgeon, a hand surgeon, and myself.
Wow. Yeah. And explain, it wasn't a typical hospital scenario.
No, it was actually some buildings on a complex where there's a church and in different buildings, and we actually had one building or a room, rectangular room, had three different tables, two for the general surgeon, one for me, and then the hand surgeon was just in a room adjacent. And it was just a regular, you know, floors, jalousie windows, you know, no operating room. It's really more of a, we call it kind of almost like a MASH type unit.
Yeah. Thing. Yeah. That's what it sounds like to me.
The kitchen was the sterilization area where we did the instruments and the sterilizing and all that kind of thing. And they actually walked them across the waiting area, or not the waiting area, the recovery area, through the one where the hand surgeon was doing surgery into our room to bring the instruments back and forth and so on.
And this was all free to those patients?
Yeah, absolutely.
And the only hitch was that they had to have transportation home.
That's what we prayed for. Yeah, that they weren't walking, because they usually walk every place.
Yeah.
And we told them, especially with foot surgery, pretty obviously didn't want them walking home.
Wow.
But one year I went down, one little boy was on the front handlebar of his brother's bike, and then there was another lady who was on the back of a scooter. And they had transportation, but it wasn't exactly what I was thinking in terms of transportation,
mm-hmm.
but they got home.
It was something.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. And you got back with about the end of February.
It was the 1st of March, actually. It was, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. And then since then, you've heard that the patients that you took care of were doing just fine.
One of the sisters had emailed us and said that they did their 2-week check, taking the stitches out, and nobody had any infections. Thank you, God.
Okay. Yeah. Well, thank you for what you did. That's very, very nice of you. And you just got back from a trip yourself. What kind of trip was that, Dr. Chubinski?
Well, my biggest concern, there's a special place in heaven for Dr. Coda for what he did. Now, I was doing a luxury thing. My biggest concern was not getting my mustache caught in that umbrella of a cocktail. You know?
And that your toilet's flushed.
Oh, quite vigorously.
Yes.
Yes.
All right. Well, I'm glad you both made it back safely, and for whatever reason you went, I hope that you had a satisfactory experience.
Very much so.
All right. Well, very good. The phone lines need to start ringing now as we ask questions about feet. I always like to start by asking, talking about feet and people walking into your offices, some of the biggest problems that you've seen here recently. What are people coming to you for?
Oh, goodness. A very common thing we see very often are bunions. Bunion deformity is a big part of what we do. And what's interesting about that, there are like 21 different procedures that we do for those just based on the nature of the patient's need.
And
it's not just one type of thing.
Before the show, we just kind of outlined what we're going to talk about, and Dr. Coda happened to mention that he was actually taking care of somebody who was not even a teenager yet who had bunions. Is that correct?
Well, the one patients recently we've done a 10-year-old and an 11-year-old, and they were actually born with a deformity, mild, and then by the time they get to that age, it was pretty severe,
mm-hmm.
and they were getting quite a bit of discomfort. And the biggest area where they really get the discomfort is actually the big toe joint, which if they can put it on the model here, but the
sure.
big toe joint in this area here is actually, again, this is the joint here is what we're talking about, and this metatarsal bone will actually come out this direction, and the big toe will actually go to the other direction. And again, a lot of it they were born with, and the youngest, again, we've done is maybe 10 or 11, and the oldest can go all the way through, you know, 80, 90s. I mean, some people mm-hmm. are in good shape, and they have good circulation to even take care of it when they're older.
Yeah, I always thought that it was an adult or an older adult type of thing, because I know my grandparents had bunion problems for years, so that's very interesting. And Dr. Chubinski, what would be one of the procedures you would undertake for bunions?
Well, I mean, they're all different procedures because they're all different types of deformities. I mean, if it's the simplest procedure, all we do is take the bump off, you know, the bump that's sticking out. Mm-hmm. If everything's in pretty good alignment, that's all we need to do. And that's like doing that procedure because that's about as hard on the patient's system as getting a cut that needed to go to the emergency room for some stitches. Mm. So that's a relatively simple thing. If there's an angulation within the bone of the big toe, we can take a wedge of bone out there to straighten it out. If there's a mild angle between the first metatarsal and the second one, just to bring it over, we can cut the bone here, move it over a little bit, pin it. If there's a big angulation back there, we have to take a wedge out or make a curved cut back here to bring it over. And the difference from the patient's standpoint, the simplest bunion, they're in a shoe for 2.5 weeks. If we have to work on this weight-bearing bone and move it over there in a below-the-knee boot for 3 weeks, if we have to do one back here, they're totally non-weight-bearing for 6 weeks. Mm. So, you know, I'll tell patients, let's do the simpler ones, you know, if we can. Don't wait till they get worse, because it's much easier on everybody. And one of the ways these can't tend to get worse, there's two tendons that pull the toe up, two tendons pull the toe down. Now, when things are lined up, that's just what happens. It pulls the toe straight up, straight down. If there's an angle there, now those tendons don't go around the bend, they cut the corner. Now when the tendon pulls to pull the toe up, it also tends to pull it over. Or the ones that are on the bottom, you know, that would pull it down, pull it over. So, you know, I've had patients say, well, it took 50 years to go that far and 1 year to go that far. Why is it getting worse? And that's just one of the dynamic forces that can contribute to that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, we're talking about toes, and we talked about the big toe here. What about hammer toes? Is that a fairly common thing that you see in your offices?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay, what is a hammer toe, Dr. Coda?
Well, in the lesser toes is where they usually occur, either the second through the fifth toes. And in each of your little toes, there's actually three little bones, okay? Now, there's two joints, like in your fingers. If you bend your fingers, there's a joint closest to the main part of the foot here. There's another joint out here. And depending on where it bends, if the toe will bend, instead of being straight back at this joint here, it's actually called a hammer toe. If it bends at the joint out toward the end of the toe, this little one out here, can actually be called a mallet toe, which would actually look at the very end bending. If both of those actually bend, it's called a claw toe, which actually almost looks like a claw. So depending on where the bend is and how much bend there is, depends on what you have to do to try to straighten it out.
Mm-hmm.
Usually if it's a bony type thing that it's already adapted itself and it's pretty much set, you can't straighten it up. You have to go in and take usually the end of one of the little bones out to basically bring the other two and straighten it up, which requires doing something surgically with it.
And claw toes can actually be caused by a few things, and one in particular is wearing shoes that are way too tight. Is that right?
Well, the shoe can aggravate things, but mm-hmm. again, a lot of the things that occur, the deformities that occur on the foot, the bunions, the hammer toes, a lot of it's because of the mechanics of the way the person's foot works. And in the lesser toes, the tendons, again, Dennis was talking about the tendons on the bottom, the top, if they contract back or pull back on the toes, eventually the toes get into a position where they stay bent, basically, and that's where the hammer toes can occur, or eventually even more severe, the claw toe.
Mm-hmm. And hammer toes and claw toes, are those primarily for afflicting adults, older adults, or just about anyone?
Well, you can see it in some younger patients. Now, you can't do younger where their skeletal growth isn't totally done.
Right.
You don't want to do anything surgically because you're going to affect the growth plates. But if their skeletal growth is done, I mean, you can see some kids into the later teens, in the early 20s, that can have problems. And then you can see it as, you know, older adults as well. So there's really no age specific. it depends on, again, the foot structure.
Okay. If you're just tuning in, we're talking to Dennis Chubinski and Vincent Coda, both physicians taking care of feet, podiatrists and foot surgeons. The telephone number is 969-2720 or long distance 866-969-2720. Last time you guys were on, we had tons of calls regarding feet issues, and I'm sure those are going to be coming in at any moment now. Talked about claw toes. One thing I did want to talk about, I'm going to mark that off the list. Hammer toes, bunions, plantar fasciitis. I'm surprised I could say that without stumbling. But what is plantar fasciitis? You want to start us, Dr. Chubinski?
Sure. Well, in medical terminology, the suffix itis means inflammation of, like tonsillitis, appendicitis, and so on. There's a band of tissue that goes from the ball of the foot and inserts in the heel. It helps to maintain the arch of the foot, like the string on a bow. As we stand and walk, the arch flattens out. And when it does, the fascia gets pulled back there. When the plantar fascia is inflamed, that's plantar fasciitis. That's where the phrase comes from.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, to give you an idea what the tissue is like, whereas, you know, when you feel the back of your foot, the Achilles tendon feels round, almost like a rope, the plantar fascia would be more like a 1-inch wide piece of fiberglass strapping tape. It's thin. It's an inch across, and it has a tensile strength of stainless steel. I mean, it is really tough. And I mean, it's got almost a personality like the fiberglass strapping tape, too, because when we cut it, I mean, you can actually feel fiber. It's like cutting celery. You can feel, you know, fibers in it giving. So it's really very strong tissue. And just by the structure, every step we take, our body absorbs shock. And the arch flattens out, pulling back there. That's also, it's a pull of that fascia that, if there's a heel spur, that causes the spur formation.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so plantar fasciitis and heel spurs are often a package deal. And actually what makes spurs hurt is not the bump of bone, because there's some days it hurts more, some days it hurts less. The bump's not getting bigger and smaller. The tissue right next to it is more inflamed or less inflamed. And classically, you know, this is one of those things where they call it pain upon arising. It hurts the most, like the first few steps when you first get up.
Right.
That's part of the personality of any chronic inflammation.
Obesity, being overweight, would that aggravate the feet and aggravate the plantar fasciitis? Excuse me, there you go.
Sure. Well, every step we take, we hit with 1.5 times our body weight,
mm-hmm.
on an area the size of a quarter.
Yeah.
You know, a 200 pounder hits with 300 pounds pressure every step you take, so sure.
The feet really are amazing things. They withstand so much weight and pressure and really abuse, and I don't think people really take care of their feet, and you probably know that very much. They just don't take care of their feet like they should. What would be some good ways to make sure that we do take care of our feet and maybe prevent some of the problems that we've already talked about tonight?
Well, one of the biggest things patients can really aggravate things is if they get a real cheap shoe or something that's not a really good supportive shoe, depending on their activity. If they're working in a factory situation or any kind of a standing type situation, store or so on, they really need something that's getting them support and not let the foot just kind of roll and do its own thing without any kind of. The big thing with a shoe, in the back part of the heel part of the shoe, I'll use this model as an example, but in back around the back of the heel in this area, it's called the counter part of the shoe. And in any shoe, you want to make sure that the part around the back of the heel as it's surrounding it is more stiff. If it's softer back around the back part of the heel, it's going to let the foot kind of roll very easily. That's one of the most important things. And depending on, again, activity, some people like a work shoe, some people like a work boot, some people like a athletic type shoe. I mean, you can use whatever type shoe you really want to work with depending on your activity. But again, with any of those, you got to make sure the counter's stiff. You got to make sure it's got a flatter outer sole. Some of these shoes that they're coming out with, and nothing against Skechers, but they try to market these things that have a rounded bottom to them. They're really not good, because the biggest problem is that we're not made to hit more on the heel and more when you push off on a roll. It's supposed to be more of a flatter, complete step type thing. So I always tell patients, try to go with a shoe that has a flatter outer sole, and then also make sure it's not a man-made upper. You want to make sure it's got some breathing to it as well.
Mm-hmm.
But the shoe makes a big, big difference just by itself. And then in cases of like diabetics and people that have to really be careful with their circulation or their general health, you want to make sure you don't do any cutting, anything sharp on your feet. I mean, people tend to become bathroom surgeons and they use sharp objects on their feet. Mm-hmm. Even non-diabetics shouldn't really do it,
right,
because you can get yourself in trouble. I mean, absolute trouble, especially with diabetics that have high blood sugars. I mean, they can, but even people that aren't diabetic, you know, can cut themselves even just a little bit and becomes infected and becomes a big issue.
Yeah, because your foot is in a very warm, isolated, and at times sweaty area, and it does not get enough air in, and it just doesn't have a real good chance to heal.
Absolutely.
Especially with the abuse that you're giving that foot. We have a call on line one. It's Debbie. And Debbie, we're going to go back, I guess, to the subject of bunions, and that's just fine. Dr. Coda and Dr. Chubinski are here to answer your questions. Go ahead. Hello, Debbie. Well, that big buildup for nothing. But anyway, here's what Debbie has asked. She has a bunion, a bunionette, and hammer toes. What is the recovery period for these?
Well, the bunion is what we are talking about. The bunion is the deformity behind the big toe, the first metatarsophalangeal joint. A bunionette would be something comparable behind the little toe.
I've never heard of a bunionette.
Well, those are also called tailor bunions.
Okay, I've heard of those.
That goes back to the, you know, meaning tailor, one who cuts fabric, you know. These guys squatted down a lot to do hems and things, and the position of their foot. It was just a very common thing among people within that profession.
Hmm.
But it's a bump of bone back here. I think Debbie's question is, what would be the recovery period? That would depend on which type of bunion that we are talking about. Classically, for any surgery, we'd want you to be on an activity level called bathroom privileges for the first 3 days, where you're off your feet religiously with it elevated. Try to keep it from swelling. Typically, within a few days, you can shower and get your foot wet. You just can't get stitches underwater. You can't take a bath. Typically, we take stitches out after about 2 weeks. At 3 weeks, we have our patients massaging their feet with vitamin E oil to diminish scar tissue, diminish swelling, increase range of motion to keep things from stiffening up. If you're going back to an activity level consistent with a pure sit-down job, especially if you could sit down and prop your foot up, you could do that within a week of the time of the surgery, as long as your desk is not very far, you don't have to walk very far to get there.
Mm-hmm.
If you're doing a stand-up walking job, it could be 6 to 8 weeks, depending on how you feel, how you heal, how you respond, and so on. And you'll have a built-in barometer there for as long as a year. You know, when the weather's changing, things might ache more. So Debbie, I'm sorry, I'm giving you like a politician's answer here. You can pick 3 days, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 6 weeks, or a year. But I mean, you as far as functionality, I think that'll give you a pretty good idea. But anytime we work on bone, I mean, as good as we are at this stuff, and Dr. Coda is very good at this, and I'm pretty good. I've learned a lot from him. you'll think of us for a few weeks after we operate on bone.
All right. Dr. Coda, you mentioned earlier about people going to the bathroom and performing their own surgery on their feet, and I would imagine a lot of that is removing calluses. Would you agree?
Absolutely.
Well, yeah. And I'm not here in no way, shape, or form are we endorsing it or really jabbing it, making it look negative, but I wanted to get your take, both of you, on this new product that, as you see on TV, that comes with patches and this gel that you put on your feet and you let it rest for a while, and then they provide a plastic scraper and it scrapes off the calluses. Have you seen this? Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, there's been things like that on the TV for quite a while.
Quite a while. Yeah. What's your take on those?
Well, the biggest, what I tell patients to do if they really want to try to help with get some of the callus off and not hurt themselves, there's a thing called a pet egg that you can get at Walmart, I mean, any of the stores.
Okay.
Basically, it's a plastic egg. It comes apart. It's got a little grater type thing on the inside. You're not going to cut yourself with it. And after they take a bath or shower, if there's a calloused area on the bottom area that's bothering them, they can use the scraper type thing on there when it's warm and moist, and it'll take some of the callus off. It's not going to fix anything, because usually when you've got calloused areas, be it on the bottom of the foot, on the side of a toe, the top, the end, different areas, even on the outside, which we were talking about a bunionette on the outside area, that's a very common area for it to occur. There's an underlying bony problem that's causing it, okay? So, I mean, you can scrape the callus up, and then it's going to come right back
in. It's going to come right back.
Right, exactly.
So how do you prevent those calluses from coming back?
That's when you see us. Okay.
All right, that's the next step.
Yeah, I mean,
After you're finished with the plastic scraper, you see a podiatrist.
Usually we'll have them come in and pretty obviously do a complete exam on them, but do an x-ray picture. A lot of times on those calloused areas, we'll have the x-ray tech put a metal marker on the area so we can see exactly where it is with relationship to the bone on the inside. So again, it can be from a bunion, it can be a Taylor's bunion, it can be a hammer toe, it can be a metatarsal on the ball of the foot that's a little bit lower than the rest of them. There's a multitude of different areas that can cause it. But usually a callus is something that's being caused by an irritation to the underlying bone.
Well, if you have flat feet, does that increase your chances for calluses?
It can, but even patients that have real high arch feet can have the same problem. Mm-hmm. Okay, so there's varying degrees. There's people that's super high arched, there's people that are flat footed, anything in between. So I mean, the structure or the mechanics of the foot does have bearing on what's going to occur. But again, when you're getting a callus there that's going to be kind of very painful, it's usually an underlying bony problem.
All right. And as we have another question coming in, I want to address this too. My cobbler, shoe repairman, knows me by my first name. I go in quite often. And my biggest problem is getting my shoes rehealed, because I tend to wear those down from the outside. I plane them down like to an angle, and so they're not flat. They just kind of fall to the right. What causes that? Is that a foot problem?
It's basically the mechanics. Go ahead, Denny.
Classically on the back of the heel, if it's at about a 45 degree angle, that's normal. That's what you should be doing, because our foot, you know, kind of touches the ground, and that's where propulsion starts. It starts on the heel, comes along the outside of the foot, rolls across the ball of the foot and outside of the big toe.
Right, so it's getting a lot of friction, a lot of wear there.
Right. Okay. Right. And just having them rehealed, that's perfectly fine for a dress shoe. Mm-hmm. You wouldn't want to do anything like that for like an athletic shoe. I remember runners used to put shoe goo on, things that are part of a shoe that was wearing out, and that's not a good idea, because what the importance of an athletic shoe is shock absorption. Mm-hmm. You need the shock absorption to avoid the overuse syndromes that we see. I remember I had an interesting discussion. I was at a conference and I saw a guy from Reebok, at the conference, and I happened to run into him that night in the hotel bar because we were waiting for dinner table. Not honest, understand? But I looked around. And I said, okay. Your bosses aren't around. Why can you pay $50 for a running shoe, $80 or $200? What's the difference? What's really the difference? And what he told me was, it's not what you see on the outside of the shoe or the inside of the shoe, it's what's in between. It's the midsole where there's shock absorption. Mm-hmm. And that's what's really important. That's why for a serious runner, $200 shoe is worth it. Mm-hmm. For a dress shoe, it's not as much a factor.
Right.
I'm glad you're intimate with a cobbler, because that's a dying profession. Those guys are great.
Right, they are. And I love the shoes I have, and I just try to wear them as long as I can until they literally fall apart. All right, well, let's go to line one. We've got a few more minutes left in the program. We have Tom. Tom, go ahead with your question.
Right. Enjoy your show very much. It's a great show. I'm enjoying this very much.
Thank you, Tom.
You're welcome. The question I have, we ran into an interesting thing with my father several weeks ago. He developed some what looked like blisters on the end of his toes, and we couldn't figure out what had happened. He's retired. He's 85 years old, semi-disabled anyway. Come to find out, I took him to my podiatrist, and come to find out, he had burned his toes. He had burned his toes on a space heater. Mm-hmm. Okay, Dad's diabetic. Now, this is the interesting thing, or the question I have for you. How much longer does it take for a diabetic's, and I know this is a matter of range, but how much longer does it take for a diabetic to heal a burn or a blister on their feet? That's my question.
Okay, thank you.
You want me to go? Okay. Now, a lot of it depends on their blood sugar levels. Circulation also, two main factors. If the blood sugar levels are very high, and usually 110, 120 would be like the high side of normal, but if they're up higher, it's like sludge in the bloodstream. I mean, I equate it to sludge in oil on a car. The blood can't get down, especially when you're talking to the toes, those vessels are very, very tiny. And so that has a big factor on it. And the other part of it is if their circulation is impaired because of the high blood sugars, you're not getting enough circulation down to those areas on the toes where it has a difficulty with healing as well. So those are probably the two main factors. And the reason he probably did the heater thing is he probably has really severe neuropathy from high blood sugars where he couldn't feel anything. I mean, they were probably cold to him, but he was actually burning them, okay, and not even realizing what was going on. And diabetics that are really out of control, a lot of times that can happen to them.
All right. Well, we have a time, just maybe, and we have to answer this one very quickly. Line three, Mary, go ahead. You have a question about ingrown toenail. All right. She had a question about removal. Mary, are you there? Okay, I guess Mary left us there. But she had a question about ingrown toenail, a very common thing in your offices.
Oh, very common, and it's something, if it's causing her any discomfort, you should get it taken care of, because it's people, you know, when you talk about removing part or all of a toenail, you get, you know, the mental pictures like bamboo shoots in the jungle in Southeast Asia, you know, it's horrific. Having a toenail removed is easier than the simplest cavity you ever had filled in a dentist's office. We just spray a cold liquid on the back part of the toe, use a tiny needle to numb it, wait 10 minutes to be sure it's good and numb so they don't say anything bad about our ancestors. Take it out, put a chemical in so it doesn't grow back.
Sounds like a pretty easy procedure. Well, gentlemen, thank you very much for coming tonight. We appreciate your candor and your information regarding the feet, and we hope to have you back again really soon. All right.
Absolutely.
Dr. Vincent Coda and Dr. Dennis Chubinski, podiatrist and foot surgeons. Of course, next Tuesday we'll be back with another show for Healthline. We'll be talking about spine pain with Dr. David Lutz in our orthopedic series, and that'll be with Jennifer Blomquist. Until next time, thank you for watching and calling in here at Healthline PBS 39, and we really appreciate your support. Good night.